today. The feature of this place, when you reach retiring age, you have to retire. That doesn't mean if you come back as a visitor, you won't be grabbed and given a job to do. Because this particular job happens to be very close to my heart, and so it is with great pleasure that, without trying to make any clever introductions, I introduce to my speaker, because he has a lot of other things to tell us, and I haven't a clue about this research he can talk about, so I can't help you there. I'll leave it all to Geoff Opat.
Actually, it's a great pleasure to have Graham introduce me tonight, because I don't know if people know, but Graham, these lectures go back, I think, to 67 or so, 1968, and he was one of the founders, so it goes right back that far, and we've kept it going all those years. Tonight's lecture you'll hear a fair bit about, I hope, but I'll mention a few things about the other ones. There is a lecture theatre. There's one in the series is not given in this theatre. All the rest are in this theatre. This old pathology theatre is very easy to get to. If you just walk out of the store and walk straight that way, 10 metres you'd be in the old pathology lecture theatre. It's that close. Just up that way. So that's where it is. And you shouldn't have any trouble getting there next time. The reason for choosing that is that, apart from the title, the acoustics of the didgeridoo, there's going to be a didgeridoo recital and other happenings on the evening. I'm not completely with it, but it looks to be a grand evening coming up. And so that's why it's a change of venue, because of the recital. There's another lecture in the series by David Jamieson. This particular lecture is about the last mission of putting exploring Mars, and that was done very, very differently. It was done on a shoestring, and all the navigation was completely different, and he's going to talk about that. The last lecture in the series was actually scheduled long before there were some very new discoveries made in neutrino physics. In the last month or two, there's been some big discoveries in neutrino physics, long awaited for observation of what's called neutrino oscillations. And they don't quite fit the bill. They do oscillate, as predicted, but they don't do this thing called oscillation, but they don't oscillate in the way predicted, according to the detail. And the person who has a theory, which is probably the main theory in the world, is Ray Volkers, who is going to give the lecture. And there's nobody in the world more up with it than he is. And so I have no doubt at all he's going to talk about the new stuff as well as the old work on neutrino physics. So that's going to be a very exciting series. But don't forget the next new venue. Now, I called tonight's lecture Atoms at Very, Very Low Temperatures. I used very twice for the following reason. Most people, when they think of low temperature, think of the temperature of liquid helium, which is 4 degrees absolute, and that became possible through the work that went on in Holland in the early days of this century, where in Britain, a thing called the Dewar flask or the thermos flask was invented, which you needed a container to put the stuff in. That was one feature of it, and the other thing was that the method of liquefying almost unliquefiable material, helium, became possible in the hands of Kamerlingh Onnes. But then this century, there's been other methods of cooling which have taken us down to liquid helium. You can get down to about 1 degree. Then you can, with various other forms of refrigeration, one of them is called liquid helium dilution refrigeration, you can get down to about 1/1000 of a degree. And the change in physics, as you go down by a factor of 1,000, is like, I mean, we're at 300 degrees absolute. If we went up by a factor of 1,000, we'd have temperatures like inside a star, and the physics is completely different. Well, every time you go down or up by a factor of 1,000, the physics is really different. And so at a millidegree, you have a very big change in physics. But tonight I'm going to be talking about two stages cooler than that. The first is at microdegrees, which that's the first very, and the next is at nanodegrees, which is the second very. And so it's going to be really two levels of serious cooling. And the amount of matter, of course, that's cooled is not a lot, but it's a significant amount, easily detectable, easily worked with, and it has very, very different properties to anything we've been dealing with in the past, and opens up new opportunities, and it's an exciting area to be in. Now, I have share a research group with Dr. Peter Hannaford of CSIRO, and we're working in this field. Most of the stuff I'm reporting tonight is not our work, but we are working in the field, and some of the techniques and things, we've been using them, although we didn't invent them, and so it's up and running. So now and again, I'll illustrate things with our own work. But we didn't. I don't want to claim to be the originators of it. Now, the reason that there are various things I'm going to talk about. One of them is I'm going to have to just remind you of the properties of gases and temperature, and then we're going to talk about different types of particles, a particular type of condensation called Bose condensation, which has been achieved, and then we're going to go into laser cooling, atom optics, how you cool by evaporation at these low temperatures, and so on, and we'll talk about all that as we go. Now, the reason for doing this is... mostly it's fun, mostly it's being done just for the challenge of the unknown. There are already some applications, though, or people trying things. It turns out that when you get really cold atoms, they take on very strong wave-like properties, and you can then image them, and people are trying to image electronic circuits out of elements, and then just have them self-photographing onto a substrate so that you can go ahead with the production of electronics. And some work has already started in that area. There's some actually going on here. Then there is the possibility of using the wave property of these particles for chemistry, study long-range interactions. I'm particularly interested in gravitation with these atoms. There's work going to hit on the fundamental constants. You can do a lot of experimental tests of fundamental physics with them. There are some other unforeseen opportunities. Since I started thinking about this lecture, hydrogen has been cooled, very, very seriously cooled to 10 to the minus 9 or so, 10 to the minus 9 of a degree. And there is the possibility that this very, very stationary hydrogen atoms can be used in clocks. People are interested in that. There is this... just to remind you, there is a connection between particles and waves, and each particle has a frequency associated with it, its energy, given as with this constant called Planck's constant, and with its wavelength, there is a momentum associated with the particle. And that's true for all particles. If they're light waves, the energy and momentum are connected with a constant called the speed of light, and for particles that are moving slowly, ordinary particles, you have the energy and momentum are related in this way. When you put these formulae together, you find that the wavelength is equal to numerically 400 divided by the velocity in meters per second divided by the mass in the chemical mass system. So it turns out that you get very long wavelengths. Normally in a gas, the atoms zipping around in the gas have wavelengths that are tiny fractions of their diameter. They're really they're like X-rays. They're very, very short wavelength radiation. But once you cool them, they become very long and have the same sort of wavelengths as ordinary visible light. And because they have the wavelengths of ordinary visible light, then you can do the sort of experiments, or you could try to do the sort of experiments that you can do with visible light. And so a whole new area opens up called optics. One particular area that I'm interested in is gravity. I'm not going to talk much about the applications tonight, but if you have a particle moving along fast, then it has a short wavelength. If it moves slowly, it has a long wavelength. And if you, for example, have a lump of matter, just a block of matter like this, then if an atom goes past, even though the attraction of this matter is so slight as to not deflect the particle very much, nevertheless, it speeds up a little bit as it gets into the neighbourhood of this block of matter, and the wavelengths get shorter. And with these slow atoms, the amount of shortening of wavelength is so large that if you could measure it interferometrically, we'd be able to measure the gravitational field of just a cup of water or your hand or anything like that very, very easily. It's very, very sensitive. And the mining company are interested in looking for lumps of matter under the earth and wanting to put devices which have this wavelength behavior in their aircraft and fly them over and see if they can see it. And we're hand in glove with the mining industry. They're actually paying for some of the research we're doing in the hope that we'll find instruments based on this coal atom work. So it's a very, very exciting thing. Now let's just go back to gases for a minute. A gas is just atoms just zipping around chaotically, and very seldom do they collide. They're tiny little objects, a few angstroms in diameter. They only occupy, you know, 1 in 10 to the 4th, 1 in 10,000th of the volume. Most of the space is empty. Some tiny little fraction of a percent is occupied by the atoms themselves at normal, under normal circumstances. The other thing, of course, that you probably know, and I'm going to be using the words temperature very loosely all the time. One of them is that there was this discovery, the work that was done on ideal gases, that if you measure the temperature in centigrade along here, and you measured the pressure in a vessel of a given volume as a function of temperature, you found that it always formed a straight line. But the surprise was that if you then extrapolated this line for every gas, no matter which gas, they all came back and the lines met at minus 273.15 degrees. And so what was realized is that 273.15 is the natural starting point for temperature. We made a mistake of worrying about ice. I mean, if we lived in a world without ice, we would have had something else to start our temperature scale off. So this is the natural starting point. And so the temperatures I'm going to be talking about tonight are absolute temperatures, which are the Celsius temperature with 273.15 added on. And that's the sort of temperature I'll be using. It's called the Kelvin or absolute temperature. And that, at this temperature, where the pressure goes to zero, the velocity of the atoms goes to zero. That's a half truth. For an ordinary gas, it goes to zero, and it represents the lowest temperature you can get, because after you've got all the motional energy out of the atoms, there's nothing left. Now, the thing I want to talk about a little bit in abstract to begin with is the refrigerator. And the way you think of a refrigerator is you have two objects. One's the thing you want to cool and the other's the refrigerator. And the hot system we represent by a long line. This is something you're trying to cool. And the thing called the refrigerator is represented by a short line. And when you put the two together, the hot system and the refrigerator form a block like this. And then what happens is there's a theorem that says that you can never change the area of this block. The range of coordinates of the hot system and the range of coordinates of the other system, which we happen to call a refrigerator, that forms a quantity called phase space. We can't change its volume, and so we just reshape it. And the refrigerator is a doolacky for reshaping things. And then when you pull them apart, the system that you wanted to cool is now short and the refrigerator is long, and so you cool it. So basically you just put two systems together and put them apart. Now, the surprising thing is that the really coldest system that you can get is really a laser beam. And that's one of the things that has turned up. Laser beam has a lot of energy, but it's extraordinarily cold. And the reason it's cold is that every photon in a laser beam is doing exactly the same thing as every other photon. If you take an ordinary low-power laser, there are something like 10 to the 14 photons, absolutely identical in every detail, coming out per second. So there's huge number, billions and billions and billions, just tearing out, absolutely identical, doing the same thing. And when you have that situation, you're dealing with something that is just so... it has no disorganization. It has no chaos in it. There is nothing random in it. It is so organized that it represents really about the lowest temperature you can get. And one of the things we're going to be doing is working out how can we put our atom gas in contact with a laser beam so that we can freeze it. And we'll come back to some of those things later on. Now, there was a group of people who, in various stages and with a long history, and these are not the only people, succeeded in doing it, and the Nobel Prize was given last year for cooling and trapping atoms with laser light. If you want to see how they look like this. Most of them actually, the only one, as far as I know, who hasn't visited Melbourne is Phillips, but Stephen Chu is really a very, very bright. He's head of physics at Stanford, and Cohen Tanuji is in Paris, and Phillips is in America. So it was a very international effort, and it was some very, very beautiful work. There are a cluster of related techniques. Now, suppose you were given the job of slowing down a tank in a serious problem. One of the things you could do is throw ping pong balls at it. Here's the, you can see for yourself how it's done. Now, the trick is to throw enough at it. Each ping pong ball does very little, but if you can fire enough, you can bring it to a halt. And every ping pong ball hits it, bounces off at random. You'll notice, let me just point out something about these ping pong balls. The tank's zooming along here in some direction or other, and you're flinging ping pong balls in it at all in this one direction. So you've got a stream of momentum in the form of ping pong balls coming at the tank. And when they hit the tank, some of them go up, some of them go straight back at you, some of them just make a glancing angle and basically go the way they were going. And it turns out that the average momentum of the ping pong balls after collision with the tank is zero, because they're in all directions. So the sum of the momenta adds up to zero because it's random in direction. But before they hit the tank, the momentum is all going this way. So the result of it is that stream of ping pong balls pushes the tank to a halt. Because it's losing its momentum. Now, the way to do slow down atoms is exactly the same. You take your atom and you fling lots of photons at it. Each one of them is flea powered compared with the amount of motion in the atom. And you need of order 10,000 to bring an atom to rest at normal temperatures. And let me give you a few details of how that's done. I just want to draw attention to the fact that light, we have lasers which give off light at a very definite wavelength, and if you move, if you have a laser there and you move into the light, then the frequency of the light will increase, the wavelength will get shorter. If you run away from it, the frequency will decrease and the wavelength will get longer, and that's called the Doppler shift, and it's given by this formula where C is the speed of light, V is how fast you're running towards or away from the frequency, the source of light, which has frequency F naught. So that's very important. Relative motion can change the frequency of a light source that you see. Now, I'm not going to again talk much about laser physics, but there have been serious developments in laser physics in the last decade. The lasers that we had to use 10 years ago or more, if we wanted to tune their frequencies very accurately, these lasers were typically worth $250,000. And so this slowed research up no end, because most people don't have $250,000. Then suddenly diode lasers of equivalent power became available, typically worth $10. Actually, they quickly escalated to about 100, but still very much less than $250,000. And these lasers are capable of being tuned, like you can tune a radio set to frequency, you can tune these little diodes. And I don't want to go into the details of how that's done, but it's very, very simple to do. And you can tune them to one part in 1,000,000,000 very, very easily, or even more, one part in 10 to the 11. You can tune them to, in terms of a frequency, if you really put enormous effort into it. You don't need that effort for most applications. So we have tunable lasers now. Now, here is an atom, just to remind you of energy levels and things in atoms. Here's an atom with an electron, some sort of electron cloud going around, and suddenly this electron cloud gets puffed up, which, you know, some sort of a conventional diagram is shown as the electron going around a bit faster or something. And this atom has this energy, and that atom has this energy. And if you have an atom which is in this state, then it can drop down and emit a photon with a frequency which is related to the difference of energies between those two states. If, on the other hand, you fire radiation at this atom, provided the radiation has a frequency which is extremely close to the difference of energies here, so that the frequency times Planck's constant is equal to the energy difference between here and here in the atom, then the atom will jump from this state into its excited state, and the photon will disappear. It will be absorbed. Now, let's just draw a picture. Here is a picture of an atom. We've got a stream of radiation fired at it, and what it does is the radiation goes in, excites the atom drops back to its state and emits a photon. So the photon seems to have changed its direction. And this is like bouncing ping pong balls off a tank. The photons come in all from one direction from your laser, and the ones that go out go off in all directions, and in the finish, in average, carry no momentum. And so the only momentum being transferred into this atom is from the stream of photons which are constantly bouncing off it. This process of going up and down typically is very, very fast. And so you can get lots and lots of photons bounced off an atom in a second. Now, this is a bit like the three bears. If it's too cool, you see, if the light is too red, it's too low in energy, then the laser light, then it doesn't have enough energy to go between the two energy levels. And here's a picture of red light hitting the atom, and the atom's just transparent, they ignore it, they can't be excited, nothing happens. If, on the other hand, the laser light is too blue, so it's got too much energy, then what happens is, again, this photon can't excite an atom between here and here, and the whole lot of the atoms are transparent, the gas is transparent. But it's like the three bears, when the temperature's just right, and you have the green light, and it's just matched to the wavelength, then it jumps up and down between these levels, scattering photons all over the place, and this is how you bring them to rest. Now, let me just say the amount of scattering from a single atom, I didn't have a chance to produce an overlay from it, but the amount of scattering of an ordinary powered laser beam from a single atom is so great that you can see the single atom with your eye directly, one atom. It sprays off so many photons per second, you just look at it, you can see it with your eye. So that gives you some idea of the rapidity of this process and the extent of it. Now, I want to put the thing together and explain to you how you make a system which cools the atoms. Here is what's the amount of scattering. This is called the cross-section, but it's the amount of scattering of light as a function of frequency. This is the frequency which exactly matches the separation of the energy levels. And when the frequency is exactly at this value, there's a huge amount of scattering, and you start to apply a lot of pressure to this atom. So here is a picture of a laser, and one of the things we've done is we've tuned the laser beam to be just a little bit below the separation of the energy levels of the atom. We willfully made the wrong energy for the laser so that it didn't quite match the energy levels of the laser. Now, here's our laser. When an atom is moving in this direction, this frequency here can be Doppler shifted. And it can be Doppler shifted upwards in energy till it matches this separation, and then the scattering starts. So here's an atom going into the beam, too slow, it's not scattering. Here's an atom going away from the beam, it sees a very low frequency, doesn't scatter light. Here is one that's going away from the beam, again, doesn't see the right frequency. Here's one that's going into the beam with just the right velocity, and it's scattering like crazy, so it suddenly finds itself being bombarded by the laser beam in the way that all the others aren't. And if you draw the force, the average force applied to this atom as a result of the light scattering on it, you find when it's got a negative velocity, by negative we mean into the laser beam, the force suddenly increases. It doesn't just go exactly off and on with a bang. It crawls up and then decreases again. Until if it's going too fast into the beam, it sees this frequency is too high and the light just goes past the atom. If it's going too slow, the light just goes past the atom. But in the neighborhood of this correct velocity, it sees a lot of scattering. Now, what about atoms that happen to be going this way? Well, you put a mirror at the other end of the apparatus, and so the light comes this way and back again, comes back again, and if you have an atom that's moving towards the mirror, then it will see the frequency going up on the light that it's running into, the reflected light from the mirror. It scatters like crazy, and so it, which was traveling in this way, feels a pressure trying to slow it down. And the force from on these atoms goes like this. Now you imagine this is the force produced by the original laser beam. This is the force produced by the reflected laser beam on an atom, and it occurs when and then, of course, when you've got the two going together, the force is the sum of these two, and it looks like this. Now the surprise is the following. When you add this graph to this graph, you get a long straight piece in the middle. And here is an example of a force which is proportional to the velocity over this range, and it's got a negative slope. And this is exactly the way, if you take a ball and you put it in honey and you try to drag it along, the viscous drag gives you a force which is trying to drag the ball back. The force is proportional to how fast you're trying to drag it through the honey. And so suddenly, when you have this folded laser beam, which is just the correct detune in the energy, in the frequency of the laser beam, suddenly the atoms think they're in honey, and they just go, and come to a halt. And that's how they're cooled. And that's the basic method of cooling of the atoms. And this, the atoms, this apparatus is called molasses, from the American for treacle. And it just says the atoms suddenly think they're in treacle and can't move. So that's the common jargon is now molasses for this. So that's how it's done. Now what's actually done is you take three laser beams, which are counter-reflected, making six altogether, in three directions at right angles, and you slow the things down. A gas is slowed down in the intersection region of the laser beams in all directions. So a piece of gas actually comes to a thudding halt in that region. Now, there's a bit more to it than this, and I'm not going to talk about another thing. That's called the cooling of atoms. There's, by applying magnetic fields as well, which one does, you can also take this little bit of cold gas and compress it, and that's called trapping. And so the process is cooling and trapping. It's just a lot of technical detail into trying to explain the trapping process. Here we have two lots of apparatus for doing it. One's a glass apparatus, and here you can see the vacuum system. You can see the magnetic coils here. You can see there's a glass above and below, so we can send laser light up and down through the system. There's glass in front and there, so we can send laser light that way, and there's another one in here, you can send laser light backwards and forwards, either three directions at right angles, and this, it doesn't take long before the apparatus is totally buried and no one can possibly see it anymore. And when in the overlapping region where the cooling is going on, there's an enormous spraying out of light, and here is a picture of the glow ball from our apparatus, just where it's glowing in the intersection region. Now the question is, how do you know how cold you got it? Well, what you have up there is a piece of gas which is about a cubic millimeter in reality, and it's relatively high density inside a glass cell, and the particular gas we're using is cesium vapor. And there is a little cubic millimeter or so of gas. Now, that's very cold. Now, all of a sudden, you just switch off everything. Just the fields go, the lasers go, everything. It's off, and you have a cubic millimeter of gas that's absolutely freezing. And it's got zero velocity, near enough to zero velocity. So it just goes, and starts to fall a half GT squared. Little drop, a piece of gas just drops, just because it just drops from rest as soon as you switch it off. And here, this little bit of gas goes through a sheet of laser light, which is collimated, and as it goes through, it gives a flash. Now, this little ball of light, this little ball of gas, is not exactly at zero temperature. It's close, it's very, very low, but it doesn't have zero temperature. It's just very small. And if you just take, forget the fact it's falling under gravity, just imagine we have a little ball of gas, it has a velocity, each particle in it has a small velocity, then if you just take off any container, the ball just grows, because every particle is just heading outwards by diffusion in all directions, and so the ball just grows. So what you do is you let this go, and as this ball falls down here, it's growing. It's growing a little bit, not a huge growth, but it grows a little bit. And the rate of growth of the ball, the growth of the diameter of the ball, is related to its temperature. It's got a high temperature, it's got high velocities in there, and the ball will get bigger quickly. If it's got low temperatures, then it will expand very slowly because it's only got small velocities in there, and it'll be a small ball. Now, if it's going to be a big ball, it's going to take a long time before the first leading edge of the ball cuts this laser beam, and then it's going to scatter light as the ball drops through from all the atoms, and then when it gets to the other side, the light will go off. If it's a little ball, and it's got a very low temperature, it will just drop through as a little pellet and go blink, and you'll get just, the light scattered will be off and on quickly. So you can measure from the duration of the light that's... Oh, excuse me. Thank you. I'll start again. You drop this little ball through this sheet of laser light. I apologize. Gee, I'm terrible. Drop it through this sheet of laser light. If this ball is grown, it will take a long time to fall through, from the top edge to the bottom edge to go through. If it's tiny, it will go through very quickly because it's only the front and back of the ball just go through very quickly. So we have a light source and a light detector, and here is the intensity of light as measured as the ball goes through the laser beam. And you can measure the time it goes through. It's 5.35 milliseconds, halfway up, and from that you can determine that we had 8 microkelvin was the temperature of the ball from the rate at which it swells. So that's, it's very, very direct. It's no thermometry, nothing. You know the temperature directly in terms of the average velocity of the particles in the ball, which is the original definition of ideal gas temperature. So these are very, very slow, and they're typically traveling, the typical atom in the ball is traveling at about 2 centimeters per second, which is very, very slow, much slower than you walking speeds and so on. So that is how we know the temperature. Okay, now I want to, That's the main cooling system, and takes you down to tens of microkelvin, and those cooled atoms have wavelengths that are like the wavelength of ordinary light, and you can make optical objects, which I'm going to talk a little bit about later on, but still not the main part of the talk. The question is, how can you manipulate and control these little atoms. Well, it turns out that all these atoms, in particular cesium, which is the one we're using, but all these rare earth ones, the electron acts as a bar magnet, and the nucleus acts as a tiny little bar magnet, which doesn't amount to much. So the cesium atoms behave as if, more or less as if, they were single electron bar magnets. Now, here is a picture of a compass needle in a magnetic field, and the energy of the compass needle is equal to the strength of the magnetic field times the strength of the magnetic moment, or the strength of the magnet, multiplied together times the cosine of the angle between them. And this represents the energy, I mean, the potential energy of a compass needle. Let's imagine you're doing an experiment. You have a field going up here, so you've got a magnetic field going up here, and you've got a little compass needle, and you put the you turn it upside down, you put the north pole down here and the south pole up down there. Well, it's not happy like that. It goes like, it wants to turn around and have the north pole looking up the direction of the field. And so it has a potential energy trying to swing it around. And so these little compass needles have a potential energy trying to swing them around. And these atoms do the same in a magnetic field. They have a potential energy. The thing that makes atoms atoms is that they're quantized. And I'm not going to go into the details. And whereas for an ordinary compass needle, you can have any old cosine of the angle between the direction of the magnet and the magnetic field, in quantum mechanics, basically the amount of angular momentum, or the related which relates to the amount of magnetic moment in this direction, projected onto the magnetic field is an integral multiple of a certain value. And this is called the quantization of the magnetic moment in a magnetic field. And so what you find when you do it quantum mechanically is that you have an energy which is proportional to the magnetic field for these little atoms. And there's an integer m which, in our case, can go up to 4. And so you have a certain couple of constants of nature, as it were. Then you have the magnetic field, then you have an integer which never changes. It's left at 4 the whole time through your experiment. And so you have an energy which is proportional to the magnetic field. Now, this is very important to understand this for what I'm saying later on. Suppose I have a nice slow atom, and I have here a region. Here's a region, big magnetic field. And the atom comes along, and it tries to enter this region, and it requires a lot of energy to enter the region, because that's the formula. Energy is proportional to the magnetic field. So it comes up to this region, the magnetic field, gets to there, and can't go in, because it just hasn't got the kinetic energy to penetrate, so it bounces off the magnetic field. So the techniques that we're using is to shape magnetic fields so that we can do things with these atoms and move them around, these cold atoms, how we want to. And we're using the fact that these atoms will be repelled by magnetic fields that are too strong. And that's going to be a recurring theme right from now on, that strong magnetic fields repel these atoms. Here is just a picture of an atom going through a magnetic field. The magnetic field's all over the place in different directions. The little bar magnet stays with its direction with respect to the magnetic field. I've drawn it as a little cone all the way. And it has this energy, the amount of energy it has depends on the local strength of the magnetic field. Now, one of the things that was noticed by some of us was that if you take bar magnets, you take a row of bar magnets, I'll show a better picture of it in a minute, and you have north, south, north, south, north, south alternating, you get a magnetic field that skips from the north pole to the south pole, like I've drawn it here. The magnetic field skips along. Now, the surprising thing is that this magnetic field, if I draw a line parallel to the tops of the magnets, if you walk yourself along the line, you discover that the magnetic field points here like this little green arrow, then in here it points vertically, then here it points this way, then here it points down, then here it points this way, you see? And actually, what's happening as you walk along parallel to the surface of this bunch of leaf magnets, the magnetic field just rotates. It just rotates. It That's surprising. It doesn't look like it, but it is. It does. And all it does is rotate. And in fact, what's even more surprising is this magnetic field is a constant. Not a constant in direction, but constant in magnitude on the just above a magnet surface. It only changes, it keeps its magnitude, but just rotates. This was something that a few of us noticed a couple of years ago. And if you have a magnet, one of these particles that can't enter too strong a magnetic field, it comes up to this surface and goes bounce and back off again, and it sees this surface as a mirror. And here's a picture of an atom bouncing off this magnetic field. Here's a picture of the atom bouncing off this magnetic field here, this surface here acting as a sort of mirror. We actually have made these. We've made two lots, and this is a picture of the size and everything of these little magnets that we cut up and bolted together and then turned into a sheet. And here is the results. Here's a picture of the apparatus. Here's our cooling thing. You turn it off, the atoms go down, drop through a sheet of laser light to let you know they've been through, hit this magnetic sheet with the alternations, and bounce back up again. And here is a picture. Here is the pulse of light we got as they fall down, and we get another pulse as they come up. And we've been able to show, because those two peaks are the same, that there's 100% reflection. There's no loss. And it just goes up and down. And what I haven't shown you is that they continue to bounce for some time. They go bounce, bounce, bounce under gravity just on the mirror. We have actually other pulses downstream. But because the mirror isn't flat, they fall over the edge. They bounce along and fall over. And so the later pulses aren't the same height. But these are just cold atoms having a little old bounce on the mirror. Now, those mirrors are hard to get very flat. And another way to do it is to produce a zigzag current and put a current through it. And this is about a centimeter. The side of this is about a centimeter. So this is a zigzag current of gold wire evaporated onto silicon substrate. And when you pass a current through this, you get a zigzag, you get an alternating magnetic field around the currents. You can compute the field exactly. That's a picture of an actual specimen. You can compute the field exactly, and you find as soon as you get away from the wires, the field becomes absolutely flat in magnitude, and the thing behaves like a mirror. So atoms come down, bounce off one of these flat planes. And the data I'm showing you now is a first run taken less than a month ago from the current mirror, and we more or less know why we didn't get 100% reflection. But these mirrors are very much flatter, and we're putting a lot of effort into making these mirrors. Now, it turns out that once you have mirrors, you can have optical systems. There are lots and lots of things you can do to make optical systems, and you actually also need a grating. And I'm going to talk to you a little bit how you can make a grating. One of the discoveries that was made in our group was, if you just take a grating and a mirror and you put them opposite each other, and you sneak light in from the edge. Here's light coming in and bouncing around inside between the mirror and the grating and then coming out again. It turns out that this, just one mirror and one grating, constitutes an interferometer. And it's the simplest interferometer you could ever make. It should be made by school children. It should just take one grating and one mirror and put them together, because the punchline is it doesn't need aligning. It works without unaligned. So you just plonk them on the table and it goes. And that took us a year to wake up why that was true. We discovered it. It's true. Anyway, this is a little interferometer, and it just looks like this. It's just these two flats. So the question is, how can we make a grating out of our mirror? And because we got a mirror, how do we make a grating? Just by the way, this is with light, this type of interferometer with light, and you get these very beautiful striations. As soon as you look into it, you just put in white light, just an ordinary, don't need to collimate nothing, just turn on a desk lamp and look in and you see the interference pattern straight away. Don't have to align it, nothing. It's by far the simplest object in optics. Anyway, so you can. The point that I'm making is that you can make an interferometer if you get one mirror and one grating. And so the question is, how do you make a grating? Now, the thing that's attracted my attention and some of the people in our group is that if you... One way to make a grating, of course, is to rule fine lines. And that's a lot of work, ruling fine lines. And we've discovered that if you take a mirror and you oscillate it like this, just parallel to itself, it splits the light into refracted orders. You don't need to actually have ruled lines on it. You can actually vibrate a mirror. Now, it turns out that the parameters for ordinary light are terrible, and it's a very bad way to make a mirror for light. But for atoms, it's absolutely ideal. The parameters are in a different range, and you can just vibrate a mirror, and it will split up into multiple beams. So we're very keen to make a vibration. Now, the mirror vibrates by such a small amount, you'll never see it. We're talking about tiny fractions of an angstrom or two of vibration, nothing you'll see. And so the question is, how do you do it? And it turns out that with the current-carrying zigzag current mirror, and this is under investigation at the moment, if you take the zigzag current mirror, which I've drawn here, and apply an external magnetic field to it, it turns out that the planes of constant magnetic field just go up and down like this as you turn the current off and on in these coils. So you don't actually have anything physical to do. Because the mirror is because the thing you're reflecting off is a plane of magnetic field, you can actually do this with the field, and we're hoping to make a grating by that procedure. Okay, so that's to give you some idea about the very cold atoms. Now I want to talk about the very, very cold. And this is just an inkling of the kind of optics that we're trying to do with them. Okay, we go back and have a look at a gas flying around again. It's going chaotically. I've just picked on one of the atoms here, and I've made life simple by making it go at right angles to one of the walls. But it's also, another view of this is that there are waves going across this box, which are the waves, the de Broglie waves of these atoms. We also love to draw another diagram in physics to display our data and about atoms, about a gas. And I've pretended that this box of gas is only one-dimensional, so that the atoms just move along a line. They don't actually move in two dimensions because I can't draw the diagram. And at any given point, they have a position on the line and a velocity. And if you draw the position and the velocity, or momentum, to be more accurate, you can look at this gas. I've simplified it down to one dimension, and you can put a dot for every gas atom because each atom has a dot, depending on its velocity and its position. So you just dot them in. Okay. And this distribution here is called phase space. It's known as phase space, and if you take a typical gas at a reasonable temperature, then the number of atoms with low momentum is high, and the number with high momentum is low. And I've tried to draw a graph of the number with a given momentum or energy. And you can sort of see that there tend to be very few up here with moving very fast, and a lot down here that are moving slowly. A lot down there moving slowly. Now, these little boxes here that I've drawn here their volume is called Planck's constant. They measure the width in momentum this way and the width in position this way, then the volume of one of these boxes is has the volume of Planck's constant, and the uncertainty relation says that you can't locate an atom better than the box it's in. You just don't know where it is in the box. It's just in the box, because the uncertainty in the width of the box is the uncertainty in position, and the uncertainty in the length is the uncertainty in momentum, and the product of those two is of order Planck's constant. And so this is the uncertainty relationship how it applies to this phase space. Okay. Now, all the particles of nature come in two kinds. And this was discovered around 1939, although experimentally it was known before, but the theoretical ideas came in about 1939, just as the Second World War was starting. The one kind of particle is called a fermion. And the fermions are all the well-known particles, electrons, protons, neutrons, neutrinos, certain atoms, which I'll explain in a minute why they're fermions, called fermions. Now, all the internal angular momentum of these objects, all these little elementary particles spin on their own axis. And there is a unit of spin, which is Planck's constant divided by 2 pi. That's the amount of rotatory angular momentum that these little objects have. And all these objects have a half of this unit of angular momentum. And they have either a half, or they have 3 times it, or 5 times it, or 7 times it. They have an odd number times this unit of angular momentum. And anything that has that is called a fermion. And one of the things that comes out of the theory of special relativity is that particles that are fermions obey a thing called the Pauli exclusion principle. And the Pauli exclusion principle says you can't have 2 of them in the same state. So there's never more than one in a cell in phase space. You can never have 2 in the same energy level in an atom. Or if you do, they've got to do something different. So one usually has spin up, one down, so they can still be different and be in the same state, and so on. But they've got to do something different. And this class of particles are called fermions. And most of the particles, with a few exceptions, are fermions. And they obey the Pauli exclusion principle. And the Pauli exclusion principle is applied to the atom, explains instantly. This principle, added to our general ideas of quantum mechanics and electrostatics, instantly explains the periodic table of the elements and all their valencies and everything. You can see a chemist up there must agree with me. And he did, he nodded. And so it's one of those very trivial discoveries which explains such a lot. There is another class of particles, you can think of these particles as having sort of BO. People don't like to be near them, and so they avoid them. There's one gets up close and goes the other way, because you can't have two together at any stage. The other particles use deodorizer, and they love to be together. They have absolutely the reverse property. They cluster if they possibly can. And the classic example of this is the laser beam. Now, the feature of these particles called bosons, is that the photon is the prime one of them all. It has an internal angular momentum of 1 unit, not a half unit, 1 unit. And it rotates on its axis as it goes along, which incidentally relates to its polarization, which you do with, you know, little... with Polaroids and stuff. This internal rotate, people don't realize when they're fiddling with Polaroids, they're actually tinkering with the internal rotatory motion of the photons. And these photons rotate on the axis with 1 unit of angular momentum. N is 1 for photons. For some other atoms, it happens to be 0, and so on. I'll come back to explain these in 1 second. And these love to be together. Now, the laser beam is the classic example where every single photon loves to go out and do exactly the same thing. It's doing the anti-Pauli exclusion principle. It's doing exactly what the reverse of electrons would do, is avoid each other. They all go together in the laser beam. And that's what gives this particular coherence, this particular intensity, this special property of lasers, is the reverse property which bosons have. Now, there's liquid helium exhibits weird behavior because of this bosonic behavior. Now, why is helium, for example, a boson? Well, helium consists of 2 electrons, which have spin a half. It consists of 2 protons, which have spin a half. And it consists of 2 neutrons, which have spin a half. That's 6 particles altogether, which adds up to spin a half. And the total angular momentum of that system has to be anywhere between 0 and 3, but it has to be an integer, and so it's a boson. If you take this one, lithium, which is also a boson, and these other ones, lithium consists of 3 electrons, it consists of 3 protons, that's 6, and 2 neutrons, 4 neutrons, excuse me, 4 neutrons. So it's got an even number of particles again, and so it doesn't have half integral spin, it's a composite system, and it, in fact, they love to be together. Okay, so now let's have a look what this means for gases. And here is a picture of a gas, and I've drawn here a series of levels here, and these are called, we'll just call them energy levels. These are the kinetic energies that an atom in a box is allowed to have. This is a rather symbolic diagram. And for an ordinary gas, the most of these energy levels are empty, not as drawn. They're mostly empty. And in fact, the chance of an energy level being occupied is about 1 in 10 to the 14 under normal circumstances. So that really, there's 10 to the 14 levels for everyone that's got an atom in that energy. And the chance of having two in is 10 to the minus 14 times 10 to the minus 14. It's very small indeed. And so the fact that some of these atoms in an ordinary gas are bosons and some are fermions, you never know, because the fermions, they never get a chance to have two in the one level because the odds are so much against it, so they don't have a chance to exclude each other. So there's no difference in a gas whether the particles of it are made of bosons and fermions. However, when you start to cool the gas, the differences show up. And as soon as you start to cool the gas, here is a gas of fermions, and you see I've only got one. This has gone to the lowest energy it can have, so removing energy from this gas. This one's gone to the lowest energy it can have. It could try and have this energy, but it can't because it's already occupied. So one atom's already got that. You can't have two with the same thing. So it drops to the next level above, and in the finish, all the bottom energy levels are occupied, and if you're not absolutely at zero temperature, then maybe one or two at the top are up a bit. But when you get to very low temperatures, all the bottom energy levels are occupied, they're packed solid, and the system is frozen up, and that's the condition of electrons in an ordinary metal, even at day temperature, very close to having this sort of distribution. All the lowest energies are occupied and none of the higher energies are occupied. So this is a picture of what happens in metals. Now, if you have Bose particles in here and you start cooling the thing and taking the energy away, they drop into the bottom level and they think, fine, another one. Might as well have them all in the bottom level, get rid of all the energy altogether. They have no problem in all going into the bottom level, the lot. And in fact, because of the deodorant effect, they actually haul each other into the bottom. It's not just a passive thing. They actually pull each other into the bottom level. After you get a few in there, the more the merrier, and they start to, there's actually a positive kind of discrimination to get more into the bottom level. And so suddenly, at a certain temperature, you pack them into this bottom level. Now, when you have a gas which has all the atoms in the bottom state, this is called a Bose condensation, and it's a very low temperature indeed to get this, but these temperatures have been achieved, and I'll show you the details. When an atom gets into this low state, you've got all the particles are doing the same thing, and so the substance takes on laser-like qualities. It behaves like a laser beam, and you've got all these atoms, for example, of rubidium, or sodium, or lithium. These are the atoms that have been condensed like. And they all go down to this bottom state. You've got sometimes 10,000, a million atoms all doing identical things, and they're all in step, and they're behaving no longer like little beepies, no longer like particles, and not just even like waves. They're behaving like intense sort of radio waves of atoms. They've got a very, in fact, easy, if you understand a radio wave, some sort of strong sinusoidal signal, that's what they're behaving like in this bottom state. Very, very much like the kind of, see, a radio, see, everybody knows how to deal with radio waves, but what you're dealing with when you deal with a transmitter is you're dealing with an object that spews out billions of photons all in the one direction, all in the radio photons, all in the one state. And so you don't have to know about photons, you don't have to know about quantum mechanics, you just look up your electronics book and get on with it. Well, what I'm saying is that this stuff, you'd be closer to understanding this if you've got an electronics book than a quantum mechanics book to understand what's going on with the atoms in the bottom state. It's more like that kind of behavior. Very, very different behavior. So now, how is it done? Well, the cooling, the last stages of cooling are done evaporatively. And I want to explain how the evaporation is done. The first thing that's done is to take those cooled atoms that have cooled the previous way and create a magnetic field around them, which the simplest configuration is two coils, ordinary single coils, and they have their fields pushing on each other. They're coming inwards. It's not what you usually do with the coils. You usually have them wound in the same direction, and so the field goes straight through. But here, they're opposing, and you get a region of null field. And it turns out that if you fiddle with the formulas for a minute, what you discover is that there is a region in here where the magnetic field at the very center point is zero, and the magnetic field grows in direction as you move away from the center point. As you get away from this point where there's exact cancellation, it grows. And in fact, if you draw a region of constant magnetic field, it looks like an Australian rules football. It's ellipsoidal. It's sausage-like rotated. It's not spherical. It's ellipsoidal shape. And I've tried to indicate it in here. So if you get atoms in there, they can't escape. They go out and they see the repulsion in all directions from the spin interaction, and they stay inside this little football-like region. And inside that region, it turns out that I can see a research student at the back, James, he knows about these things. But it turns out that the atoms, there's a pinhole where the magnetic field goes to zero, and for a sort of reasons they can sneak out through the pinhole. And there are tricks for blocking the pinhole. One thing you do is to, this is not a very good diagram, but this is sort of like a section through the football. You have a football and you have a laser beam going up the axis of it. And it turns out right in the center where the field goes to zero, the atoms can actually sneak out. But it turns out by passing a laser beam through there, which knocks them away from the center hole, you can actually have them inside this football-like region forever. Now, let's see, I need another diagram. Let's see where it is. Ah, here. Now, I've simplified the picture of the football-like region I've just drawn it as a one-dimensional thing. See, what's happening is that this particle inside this football heads off in some direction, and it's repelled backwards by what it thinks is a spring-like force. And then if it goes in this direction, it's repelled backwards by spring-like force, and like that. But this spring-like force is just magnetic repulsion in all directions. But it thinks it's connected to springs. So it's oscillating away inside this thing as if it was connected like a harmonic oscillator. So I've just drawn a harmonic oscillator in one direction. And here are the energy levels of the harmonic oscillator. And so inside this little football-like region, the atoms are all going backwards and forwards in these energy levels like this, going backwards and forwards. And they're actually waves, and these atoms are in the form of waves which go across the football. Now this football is about half a millimeter long. I'm giving you, it's not microscopic. It's small, but it's not microscopic. It's about half a millimeter long. And the bottom state here, so this would be about half a millimeter, and this bottom state would be about a tenth of a millimeter. So you can see it with your eye, but not easily. And easily with a magnifying glass. So we're dealing with a macroscopic object, and these atoms now, caught in this little football thing, are even the ones in the bottom are about a tenth of a millimetre across now, their wave, they are that cold. The frequency required to flip an atom from this level to this level is about 50 hertz. It's like the power supply frequency. It's very low. These are very, very low energy systems. Now, all these atoms whistling backwards and forwards are interacting with each other through the van der Waals force, and each one is having its energy adjusted a little bit as it goes past the others. And this collection of atoms in these levels takes on a temperature. And at a certain temperature, the number in the various levels, the number in the lowest level has a certain value, and as you go up through these levels, the numbers get less and less. If you cross a certain temperature, which is called the critical temperature, you find essentially all the atoms are in the bottom state here. They all have this single blob form, and you have tens of thousands of atoms all in the bottom state, all with some wave function, all doing the same thing on top of each other. And that's the Bose state. When they're up here in this condition, there are regions where there's a high probability of finding them near the edges, and you get no probability where the wave function goes to zero here, no probability there, etc. Okay, so this is how the atoms arrange themselves in the well. Now what happens is that you now have to, here is a picture of a bowl of water which is warm and it's evaporatively cooling itself. And what happens is that there are, inside the water, there are fast and slow water molecules, and some of the fast ones zip through the surface because they've got enough oomph to go through the surface, and then the wind takes them away and they never come back. And so what happens is that the average energy of the ones left behind drops, and so the temperature drops, and that's how evaporative cooling takes place. And that is exactly how the cooling takes place inside this little Aussie rules football shaped region inside this magnetic field. You've got all these atoms in there. They stay in there for a while, and it takes them about a minute to come to a temperature. They interact with each other, and after about 60 seconds or so, they take on a definite temperature. And there are, in particular, they're all little bar magnets, and I've drawn the bar magnets on just two of them. And there's a lot more down below in the low energy levels, and there's a few of them at very high energy out near the edges of the football, right near the edges, near the skin, where they're out there. And these ones go out there and spend a lot of time. Now, it turns out that if you turn on a radio frequency wave into the cavity, fire it into the neighborhood of this little football, if it's got exactly the right frequency, the spins of these two here flip upside down. They flip upside down. And then the sign of the potential energy of this well flips its sign, so they suddenly think themselves in a potential well that's just jumped upside down. And of course, this is like having them inside a bowl, and then you turn the bowl upside down, you put them on the top of the bowl, and they roll away. So what happens is they roll away, and this is how the hot ones at the top evaporate. This is the evaporation mechanism. You just wait for them to equilibrate, turn on a radio wave for a split second, and they evaporate. Then you wait another minute. You turn off the radio wave, wait another minute, and all these atoms get together again and rearrange a temperature. But the new temperature is lower, because the high energy particles, which were keeping the average up high, have gone. And so they've gone, and so you then don't need such a big magnetic field to hold them in, because they're now not traveling very fast. So you turn your currents down in your magnets, and here's the new situation, and you put in some more radio frequency, and boom, you get rid of a couple from the top level, wait another minute, they rearrange their temperature again, and as every time they get colder, they're packing down into the bottom state. And eventually, after of order half a dozen cools, or cooling shots, that order, it's not some infinite number, you end up with somewhere between 1 million and 10 million particles all in one state in the bottom of the trap. Now, how can you see them? What's there? Well, literally, you... I'll show you some bad pictures first, then some good pictures to understand. This is a picture of, you've got this little region in space. It's just, there's nothing actually to see. There's no material thing there. It's just this football-shaped region of magnetic field, and you've got atoms inside it, and they spend most of their time around the walls of it. So if you shine light through, illuminate it, the scattering of light takes place around the edges, and you can image it with a sort of a microscope setup, and you get this picture of the where the atoms are inside this little football-shaped region. And now you start to cool it, and suddenly you find there's a whole bunch piling up in the middle. In the middle. Here they're piling up in the middle, and eventually they totally pile up in the middle. And here is this experimental data. This is experimental data, not, although it's colorized and imagized and everything else, this is the cross-section through the football. It's the density as you go across the football as done by the transmission of light. And when you're at high temperature, above what's called a critical temperature, you just see the distribution, statistical average number of atoms, that first peak, inside the hump. Now, as soon as you go to near the critical temperature, suddenly a huge number of atoms occupy the zero state, and they all just pile up in this thing. And then when you get very far below the critical temperature, the whole lot are in there, and you have all the atoms in one state. This is not theoretical. This is a direct shot, photographic shot, produced in colour, showing you the distribution in that state. And at that stage, the temperature is about 100 nanokelvins. We've gone down from a factor. This evaporative cooling has taken us down by a factor of 1,000. So we've got 100 nano. So it's 10 to the -9. So before we did it, we were dealing with temperatures like 10 to the -6K. So the evaporative cooling took us down to that. So this is the really. I don't know if we'll ever get lower. The aim is not really to get lower and lower in temperature. Now, if you turn the magnetic field off, the contents of the little football drop, and you can shine light through, and here are shots of repeated laser pulses showing the droplet falling and expanding out of that little quantum state. Every single atom that's in this blob here that's falling is doing exactly the same thing. They're all in the one Bose state. And the proof of it came with a brilliant experiment. This works in the following way. Imagine we have this droplet falling, and then you just fire a laser beam that's focused into a line at it, and you go bang, and you blow, literally blast all the atoms from the middle of this one quantum state out. So you just chop this drop straight in half. Then you're left with two radio waves, one on each side here. I'm using metaphor for these very beautiful states, which are very wave-like and very radio wave-like states. You've got two bits here, and these radio waves go all over the place, but in particular they go into each other and interfere. And it's exactly as if you had two cavities with radio waves in. You cut pinholes in the cavity, let the radiation out, and you would see an interference pattern. You have two separate cavities. Now, this is what you see in the intensity of atoms as they're allowed to interpenetrate. Here the two blobs have interpenetrated, and you can see the wave-like interference of this very, very low quantum state as they go into each other. Here's a little less fancied up, colorized picture where you can see the interference pattern of the two waves going into each other. This is recorded on a CCD TV camera just behind the drop with light going in and scattering from the atoms. So this represents the quantum interference of these extraordinarily highly populated, very coherent, low energy states. We have a proposal. This is going on at several labs in the world, of order half a dozen labs in the world. We have a proposal to fund it. We're interested in trying to make a source of this kind of condensed fluid to feed our other experiments in optics, because there's some nice things you can do if you have this. So whether we get funded or not, I'll know in October. But this is the sort of research that's going on, and I think maybe I should stop at this point. Thank you. Okay. The answer is they're actually... Thank you for us. let's see. It turns out that the atoms are, although they're very close in energy, they're actually a long way away in space. And they're not very close to each other. They're actually a long way away. And it's the distance between them which is such that their van der Waals force of attraction, which is enough to make them equilibrate in temperature, is still not, with those densities, enough to make them gel into. But let me say there are systems where it does happen. Let me also say one other thing, just to keep going on that line. It turns out that about a week ago or 2 weeks ago, this was done for hydrogen, which is very important. And you take hydrogen atoms, and here's the electron with its spin, like that. Now, if you take two hydrogen atoms, and here's an electron with its spin like that, these two hydrogen atoms will combine, if their spins in that configuration, to form a hydrogen molecule. And it's very hard to stop. But if you take a hydrogen atom with its spin up, and its hydrogen atom with its spin up, so you lock the spin of the electron onto a magnetic field and never let it change, those two hydrogen atoms cannot react, because the hydrogen molecule has these electron spins folded, and they become non-reactive. And so a gas of non-reacting hydrogen atoms is made, so they can't react. And these have just been both condensed. This is very exciting because it's a fundamental particle for the hydrogen atoms, and there's a large number of really interesting experiments that can be done on it, and that's really, really exciting. But that's an example, you see, where you have to actually go out of your way to make sure they won't chemically react. That's the counter side to your question. So they do sometimes.
Thank you, Jeff. What actually happens to the electrons? I mean, the atoms are slowed up, and I think, but the electrons obviously still spinning around.
Yeah, they're just clouds that are doing whatever they were doing.
And they don't get slowed down by this process?
No, they're just frozen in. But they've been frozen in long before.
Right. And the second thing was, I've just been reading about how they've used lasers to nuclear fusion. It seems to be the reverse of what we're talking about, wet cooling. And now they're also using the lasers to, in fact, implode the hydrogen to higher states.
Yes, you're right. In the fusion, they're just using lasers as a crude energy dump, to dump energy. Let me explain to you the following thing. If I take a brick and put it in the refrigerator, it's a cold brick. If I throw it at you, it's a high energy cold brick. Okay? And they're using the bricks. I'm throwing bricks. I'm using the cold. That's the difference. Yes, okay.
I've got
two
questions.
They're not being used, they're funding it, hoping
the
hope.
Is it the same technology, or is it the same technology for cancer cells?
purely gravitation. It's purely gravity we're looking for. And the wavelength of these atoms is changed by gravity. No. I only know a technical answer. While I'm standing here and the time I've got available, I haven't thought through sort of an explanation. I'm not going to cover the board with maths, but you can show the way the maths turns out is that the probability of the next one joining a system is proportional to the number already in it. Plus one. So if there's none in it, it still has a probability of getting in. That's the way the formula turns out. But it's not an answer to your question. I'm just telling you how it presents in the maths. If I have a magnetic field like this, and I have a little bar magnet, which is north-south, that's in its lowest energy state. This in fact would be attracted into this magnetic field line like that. If I had a little bar magnet, I had some magnetic field going like that, but not over here. It sort of got weaker over here. Then this thing would be pulled into here. If I had exactly the same situation, but the bar magnet's upside down, so it's south-north, it will find this repulsive, and it will bounce off these field lines, because it just reverses. Now, what the radio wave is doing is flipping the magnet up, and it's the same magnetic field, and just then suddenly it's repelled. That's what's going on. Yeah. It's exactly this nuclear magnetic resonance tomography that they're doing in your head in that down at the Austin Hospital and all places. It's just the spin. It's just the spin resonance just applied to this. It flips the spin over and goes. Actually, can I just say that when they're moving, no, you're not quite right in one regard, you're very close. When the atoms are moving, the photon that comes out is not the same as the one that went in. Yeah, it'll be up or down a bit as needed. So the energy is conserved.
And the second question is, which also applies to this problem, when you were discussing again of atoms moving in a beam of laser light, and as an atom was moving relative to the beam, the atom was actually seeing a particular wavelength. Now that would mean that had it moved at a different velocity, the wavelength, the beam would actually through the atom like as it was transferred.
I cheated. You got me. Okay. Let me say the following thing. There is a thing called line width, and these atoms, it's not actually what I didn't want to get involved in the whole problem. If here's the two energy levels, and it turns out that this top energy level is not exactly one place, and it's got a width, and this width is typically about 1 in 10 to the 9 of this separation. And it turns out the miracle is that the range of velocities is just such that the way to say it is this, that you have this low frequency laser beam, the thing moves into it, and if it's moving slowly, it feels a little bit of force. As it speeds up, it moves, as it were, up, up and up and up on this until it hits the peak here. It's not quite an all or nothing. Very close, but it's enough to save the day.
Yeah. Enough to slow them down. Slow them down a bit, then it goes and gets burned again.
In this laser cooling, there are, just as I described it, you have a laser beam come in, you have a photon, the last photon goes out this way. As it goes out, it might leave the atom with a little bit of motion. And if you do the statistics of it, you find that the atoms have a statistical residual velocity. It doesn't go to zero. And that represents the final temperature of this method. Does that answer your question?
I mean, it's kind of staying at the very high temperature, say,
And you start off. For the record, you start at room temperature, 300.
Right, yeah.
And down it goes to 10 to the minus 6.
Would you have to gradually alter the frequency of the.
No. It's just locked in at one value and it goes down.
If anybody else does have a question, I'm sure Jeff would be very happy to answer it individually. If you'd like to come down and speak to him, we can move it out.
Don't forget, next time it's down there.
Yeah. As always, tea and coffee are served. Also outside on various tables, there are programs for the whole series. Nice, too late. But the next three, as Jeff says, next week's will be through. And I haven't taken the opportunity to put in the plug for myself. I'll be out there, I'll set up shops and my old lecture notes. If I can't support them, $10 a head. I'm talking to my old friends quite regularly, including on this. Now I would ask you to join with me once more. Thank you, Jeff.